Students, a very good morning and welcome to the class. Students, as you know, we have been doing the summary of the novel Oliver Twist chapter wise. Today we are going to do summary of some two or three chapters. Students, we have come to know that Oliver is ill and he is being taken care of, and the doctor is being called. And the doctor leads the ladies up to Oliver. They are shocked by how young and gentle looking he is. Rose cannot believe he was willingly the associate of robbers, regardless of the doctor's assurances that a pleasant outside does not necessarily mean a pleasant inside, and says that even if he was, it must have been because of a rough childhood. She thus begs her aunt not to let them take him to prison, to which her aunt easily agrees. The doctor says that he will help them to help Oliver to recover, unless they find him to be hardened in vice upon interviewing him. Oliver finally wakes and they are able to hear his story. When they listen to Oliver's story, students, all of them are deeply moved, and so the doctor decides that they must find a way to help him. He goes down to question Giles and Brittles in front of the constable and tries to bully them into saying that they can't swear for sure that Oliver is the boy they saw the night before. Before they can answer, however, the officers from Bull Street, who had been called in the morning, arrive. Students, the name of the officers are Mr. Blathers and Mr. Duff. They come in and request an interview with Mrs. Miley. Mr. Losbourne tells them the story of the robbery. Officers now believe that the robbery was the work of men from the city. Both the officers examine the scene of the crime, then interview the servants. Mr. Losbourne and the ladies wait anxiously, hoping that they will not take Oliver away. Rose thinks that they should tell the officers the truth, but Mr. Losbourne thinks that it is a bad idea. The only probable thing in Oliver's tale are those areas in which the boy does not look good. His good intentions and unwillingness to participate in crime are impossible to prove. When the officers go in to see Oliver, he is very ill, and Mr. Losbourne gives a cover story to explain his wound. Giles says that he cannot swear that it is the same boy, and Mr. Brittle says that he wouldn't have recognized him anyway, but only took Giles' word for it. Giles, instead of being embarrassed, is relieved to think that he probably didn't hurt a young boy. The officers are convinced and they leave Oliver to Mrs. Miley, Mr. Lobson and Miss Rose's care, under which he gradually thrives. Students, Oliver, who has been very ill, takes a few weeks to recover, and as he regains his strength, he is desperate to show his gratitude to Mrs. Miley and Miss Rose for taking him in, but he is still too weak to be able to do anything. Rose tells him that they are planning to take him to their country house soon, where he will be able to spend more time recovering. He expresses interest in being able to see Mr. Brownlow and Mrs. Bedwin again, to be able to express his gratitude for their earlier assistance, and Rose says he shall as soon as he will. Students, when this day comes, Oliver sets out with Mr. Losbourne, but on the way he recognizes the house by Chesty Bridge. Mr. Losbourne runs in but finds only an angry and crazy hunchback who insists that he has lived there for 25 years. Mr. Losbourne assumes Oliver has made a mistake. When they finally get to Mr. Brownlow's house, they find it empty with a to-let sign, and hear from the neighboring servants that Mr. Brownlow left the West Indies 6 weeks earlier. Oliver is gravely disappointed at not being able to express his gratitude or clear his name to Mr. Brownlow and Mrs. Bedwin. Mrs. Miley and Rose leave shortly thereafter with Oliver to go to their cottage in the country. Oliver enjoys the time in the country greatly, walking with Mrs. Miley and Rose, getting tortured by an old man in village, gardening and going to church on the getting tutored by an old man in the village, gardening and going to church on Sundays. By summer, Oliver is finally healthy, but health does not diminish any of his gratitude and greatness. One day, while Rose is playing the piano, she starts weeping. She cannot stop, and it comes out that she is very ill, but has kept her illness a secret so as not to alarm anyone. Mrs. Miley sends her to bed and tries to comfort her, but she makes it clear to Oliver that she is very worried about her. The next morning, Rose is quite unwell. Mrs. Miley sends Oliver off with a letter to summon Mr. Losburn. Oliver goes as quickly as he can, and after having sent it, as he is leaving, he runs into a tall man who he supposes to be mad and who has a fit. Oliver gets help and then runs back to Mrs. Miley. While Oliver has been gone, Rose's condition has grown significantly worse. Mr. Losburn comes and thinks there is very little hope. Rose falls into a coma, but to everyone's surprise, awakens, and Mr. Losburn is convinced that she will make a full recovery. Upon hearing this, Mrs. Miley faints with great joy and exhaustion. Oliver goes out to get flour to bring Rose. On his way home, he sees a post chaise drive by very quickly with a man inside who seems familiar to Oliver. It is Mr. Giles, who sees Oliver and asks him for news of Rose. Mr. Giles weeps with joy upon hearing the good news. Another man, Mr. Harry Mile, Mrs. Harry Mile's son, is in the carriage too. When they reach the house, Harry is angry that Mrs. Miley did not notify him sooner of Rose's illness, as he is deeply in love with her. Mrs. Miley does not fully approve because she fears that over the time Rose's doubtful birth and rumors about it will cause Harry to resent her, but she says that she will not stand in Harry's way. Mrs. Miley goes in to see Rose, who is too weak to see anyone else, and Mrs. Losburn, Harry and Oliver spend the evening together. Harry begins to go with Oliver on his morning flower gathering expeditions. Students, one evening, Oliver falls into a kind of half sleep without studying. In this state, Oliver thinks he hears Fagin and other men and is woken up by their voices. He is troubled to see them standing right on the other side of the window, and when he raises his head, they make eye contact. It is clear that they recognize him. Oliver too recognizes them, Fagin and crazy men from outside the post office. He jumps into the garden and calls for help. Students, this section of the novel, as we have gone through, represents the first prolonged period of real happiness that Oliver ever enjoys. We are not at all surprised to see that Oliver flourishes in this setting, finally gaining his health and happiness and losing none of his virtues. In Rose, we see one of the few adults who truly is willing to listen to Oliver and judge him by his whole life and self, not just by his actions. Even if he has fallen into a life of crime, he believes it must only be because of the hard upbringing he has had, an idea ignored by almost every other adult character in the novel. Rose's complete trust of Oliver reflects two other themes introduced earlier in the novel. It is based almost solely on his face, his size, and something indescribable about him. Thus, again, a person's physical countenance is shown to reflect his, her character, while Mrs. Losburn wants again such assumption. It is Rose who is correct in this case. Similarly, although the characters and the readers are unaware of it at this point, Rose and Oliver are related, and thus their immediate taking to each other reflect the underlying importance of familial relationships. The happiness in the country is not totally complete. However, Oliver regrets not being able to show Mr. Brownlow and Mr. Bedwin his gratitude, and Rose falls gravely ill. Both of these dilemmas will be solved later in the novel, but their existence here serves to remind the reader that bad things can and do happen to good people, and everything does not always get wrapped up perfectly, although in this novel it will upcoming pretty close. In this section, student Dickens' tendency to withhold information from the reader is emphasized via the figure of Monks. Monks has appeared in moments throughout the novel so far, but often unnamed or by alias. In the country, we see him run into Oliver for the first time, and while the reader is aware of this being significant and thus is more informed than Oliver, the reader still does not understand the root of the significance. The reader's and Oliver's ignorance, represented in the figure of Monks, will continue almost until the end of the novel and the final reveal. Students, this much for today. We will continue with the summary in our next class. Thank you very much.